Good morning. That's not right. Got a question. Do y'all feel like it's getting dark out? Just like the world in general just is getting dark. It just seems like that sin is overcoming the world, and that you see just more and more debauchery and more sin is just becoming more and more normal in this world. Does anyone feel that way? Yeah, I feel that way. And, you know, America, we're the Christian nation, and it's kind of what our principles were set on. And Christianity kind of moved out from Europe and from Israel all over the world. And at many times throughout history, you've seen where Christianity has been, you know, the major religion in the world. And you've seen God move throughout it. But it seems like right now that it's like, it's coming back in. It's not spreading. It's coming in. Less and less people are believing, and less people are turning to God. And I was just thinking on that this week. And I was brought, if you can go one over, or go two over maybe. I don't know if this is going to work, Damon. So we're going to read through Ephesians 1 through 11, but before I do that, you know, I was trying to think on, like, why is that? You know, if you go out and you go talk to people, you talk to young people, and you see that so many young people have no purpose. So many young people, they have no purpose in life, and you even see it with old people, that people, they just have no purpose. Everyone's just serving themselves, and it's like an emptiness. All these people are empty, and they're depressed, and they're full of sorrow. And it seems like that's the world now. And then in it, you can say, man, how is life? And when you really get down to it, they'll say, it's dark. There's like, it's just a cloud of darkness over me. And I talked to so many people like that. There's just a cloud of darkness over them. And a lot of that comes from just no purpose in life. And we're just looking for all these other things to give us purpose. And I read this quote not too long ago, and it said that those without purpose look for entertainment to fill their time. So like people who don't have purpose, they constantly have to go to entertainment to fill them. Because if you have no purpose, you're not doing anything. There's nothing you got to prepare for. There's nothing that you have to be working towards, so you're trying to have something to fill you. So you keep having to go to entertainment to fill you. And that seems like that's the world, that they have to constantly go to entertainment to fill them. And that can be us. It's like you don't have any purpose what you're doing, so you just go back to entertainment. Let me be entertained. Because you don't have to prepare for anything. You don't have to get ready for anything because you have no purpose. There's no reason. So we're going to go to Ephesians 1, 11 through 14. It says, in him we also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his wills. So we are predestined. He has chosen this nation of people according to his purpose to work all things according to his will, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. So that we who trusted in him, it is so that he has praise and glory. So like for us, we're made to bring about praise and glory to God. Next slide. In him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, whom also having believed, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is a guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. So we're waiting for this guaranteed inheritance to the praise of his glory, so that he has praise and glory. So like our purpose in this life is to bring about this praise and glory to God. So you can go to the next slide. So we who have trusted in Christ should live so that we may have praise and glory to God, so that he might receive this praise and glory, that our lives should be to bring about praise to him and glory to him, that he's honored and praised. And then he has given us his Spirit so that we can walk in this command, so that we'll actually bring glory to him. So he didn't just say, hey, look, bring glory to me, bring praise to me. He said, hey, I'm going to tell you how to do that. I'm going to give you my Spirit to show you how to do that. So then the first question would be, is that your purpose? Is that our purpose in this life? Or the things that we're choosing to do in this life, is it for that? Is it to bring glory to God or bring glory to ourselves? So I want you to really think and consider that. So next slide. So Ephesians 2, 8 through 18. It says, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So God prepared these good works and told us how to live, and we were made for that. We were made to walk in the way that he has told us how to. And if we're made for that, if that's what he made us for, you would think that we're not going to have any fulfillment unless we do that. Unless our life is about that, you're not going to have fulfillment. So when the world around us looks dark, and they feel consumed, is because they're not doing what they're made for, or we're not doing what we're made for. Next slide. Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcised by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that or that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world, that at one point we were the same way, and we didn't have this hope in God. We didn't have this hope in this promise. And that's why the world feels that way, because they have no hope. They have no hope in his promise, no hope to be a part of his family. And we can be the same way if our hope is not in that. Next slide. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one, has broken down the middle wall of separation. Next slide. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man from the two, thus making peace. So God has broken down our sin and washed away our sin and those things that we had done wrong. God has washed away our criminal record so that we can be at peace with our Maker. So that we can then be in communion with our Maker like it was in the garden. And then we can hear him and live for him like he had originally intended inside the garden. This is what Jesus did, that we could then walk after him in the way he created us to live. And that he might reconcile them both to God in one body through the cross, thereby putting to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off and to those who are near. For through him we both have access to one Spirit, to the Father. Through Jesus, Yeshua, we have access to this Spirit who would then guide us in the way to live and then would give us that peace that we so desire. So next slide. So what do we got from that verse? God has created us to walk in his good works, and you will never find purpose or peace or true satisfaction until you walk in the way he created. Like we won't. We'll just keep searching for something until we actually walk the way he created us to live. The last point, the Messiah has brought you close to God so that you will know how to live like you were created. Like that is where that joy comes from, that you get to be close to the one who created you. And then you'll have joy because you're doing what you were made for. And we know from the wisest man who lives, the next verse is in Ecclesiastes 12, 13 and 14. It says, Solomon had done all this stuff. He had had many wives. He had riches that you cannot not imagine. He had all this stuff. And then when he comes to the end of his life, he comes and he says this. He says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. What is our full purpose in life? He says, to fear God, keep his commandments, for this is man's all. This would be your all, your everything, is to obey your Maker. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. So he's saying, look, all that's going to matter at the end of this, all that's going to matter at the end of this life will be whether you obeyed God or not. That will be what matters. And then all of our works will be judged accordingly. So all of us, at the end of it, we're going to go stand before God, and we're going to be judged accordingly. I was telling everyone last night, you know, there's, if you are on social media, there's all these things about, oh, this life is a simulation. You know what I mean? It's almost like a video game. And, you know, really, that's what Scripture says. Scripture says that this life is a test that will determine your eternity. That this life right here, all of it's going to burn up. That all this stuff that we have here, that one day it's going to be, it won't matter. The only thing that will matter is if your heart was set to follow Christ. And then all that you did in this life for Christ, all that you did in this life for God, you'll be rewarded for it. All that you did for yourself is going to be burned up. That's what he says. That's like the whole of Scripture is that, hey, what you do in this life for Christ, you have an inheritance for. What you do for yourself will be burned up. So I want you to stop one moment right here. I want everyone to close your eyes and imagine with me a moment. So think of yourself in this body that you just take off your body. You take it off and you leave it in your house. And you is your soul that you see right now. You're in your soul. And you can see your body inside your house with all your possessions. And everybody that you know who does not know Christ and have not committed themselves to Christ, put inside that house. Now take a match and set it afire. All your kids that you know are not living life for Christ, put inside that house. All your friends that you know that you haven't spoke to about Christ, put in there, who are living for themselves. And now let it burn. And let it be just a heap of ash. Then next to you, the works that you've done for Christ, look over at the works in your pile that you've done for him. The ones that you've brought with you, be next to you. And you're going to see a bunch of things inside that house that burned up that you thought were matter. And then see yourself in front of this holy God. And think of what he would say to you. All this stuff in this world that we think will matter, that you do with your kids that you think will matter, God has said that they will burn up. And the only thing that will matter is that your heart is set to follow him and that you live a life for him. And all those people that you care about what they say that are living contrary to God is going to burn up. It's going to be gone. And the only thing that will matter at the end of this will be what you do for Christ, what you do for his kingdom. So I want you to think, has your life been committed to bring glory to God? You can open your eyes. This is such a sobering thought to me. I don't think of it that way. I don't think of it in a way that this is like a video game. And God says that your soul is going to be what's going to inherit eternity. This body that you might care a lot about, this body, will pass away. And all the trouble you go through inside this life will be to change that soul inside of you for eternity. So the hardship in your life will be to change your soul for eternity. But you understand something? You're leaving behind almost everything that you work for in this life. We're leaving it behind. And your whole purpose in this life is to bring glory to Him, not to yourself, not to your kids, because all that stuff's going to pass away. And it's going to be on fire. All the trophies you've won are just going to be ash. Think of this. I just think of like a trophy, me taking this trophy up to God. God, look, we won this for you. And He's going to say, but he's in hell. But the one I loved, your child, he has separated me from eternity. He is gone. But you won this trophy for me. You built this wonderful house for me. It is worthless. And God just has this on my heart today, like, man, it won't matter. It won't matter. The only thing that will matter will be what you do to bring glory to Him. Whose heart you turn to Him. All that other stuff's going to be gone. And unless we live a life for that, it will be worthless. And we will be searching for something to fill our hearts in this life that's going to burn up. This is not my message today. This is all I could think of whenever we were singing. It's all I could think of when he was reading. Just me sitting there before God, thinking about all these things that I've done. That I'm going to be like, oh, this is for you. And it's going to be like, just ashes falling down. God, this is for you, and just falling down before Him. These people I love that I'm just like seeing off in the distance, I'm like, no, please save them. Please, I wish I could have just spoke to them a little more about you. I wish I could just bring you here. And I'm just seeing this in my mind like, oh my goodness. It won't matter. And I don't know why he put this on my heart today. Can y'all see it? Can you see it? Do you see that? Like, can you see your ones that you love? Can you just see it pass away? Can you see those things that you've spent all your time on that just burn up? This is just like a test to see if we'll serve Him. This is just like a time that He's saying, I want to form you into my image. This life is to form you into His image. It's to form your children into His image. And all those things we think will matter, they won't. But we'll see where we'll go from here. Philippians 2, 12 through 16. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for His good pleasure. God is working in you for His will, for His good pleasure, not for yours, not for mine, for His good pleasure. Next slide. Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. So live this life without complaining, so that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. It's dark outside. It's crooked and perverse outside. Among whom you shine as light in the world. You shine as light in the world. Next verse. Holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Holding on to Christ. holding on to him so you won't get to the end of it and say, man, I labored in vain. I did all this stuff, this worthless stuff. Next slide. God works in you for his good pleasure, because that's what we're created for. You follow his promptings, and then you will shine as light into this world. That will change the world. And what does he want? He wanted us to be so full of his Spirit that the world will see him in us, that they change. Next slide. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever, amen. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you are called, with all lowliness and gentleness and longsuffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bonds of peace. So, hey, look, you're a prisoner of the Lord. I want to encourage you and beseech you to just cry out to you that you would walk worthy of the calling, that the God of this universe has called you to bring glory to him. And you walk worthy of that. With which you are called, with lowliness and gentleness. That you are lowly, not thinking great of yourself, and gentleness. Suffering when someone wrongs you. Bearing with one another. Getting over your differences with others. Working hard to keep the unity of the Spirit. Working hard to keep the body together. Next slide. Because there is one body and one Spirit. Just as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and the Father of all, who is above all and through all, and you all. Next slide. So what can we get this? That all this is for Christ's glory. You giving up of yourself when another wrongs you. You not trying to be like the world is all to give glory to him. But we are called to walk lowly and gentle and be long-suffering. But like that's so different from the world. The world wants you to be prideful. Wants you to be, oh, I can't believe they wronged me. I can't believe that they don't believe like I do. I can't believe that they don't look exactly like me. I can't believe they don't have the same political beliefs as me. And they don't believe everything about the same thing that I do. I'm offended by these people, so I need to tell them that they're wrong. Bearing and enduring with each other to keep the unity of the Spirit. So our duty as the church is to bear with each other to keep the unity of the Spirit, so the body works together as one body to accomplish God's work. Does the church work that way right now? Do we work together as one body? And have we been part of that problem? Yeah. Our duty as the church is to bear the burden of others so that we can walk together as one body, so the world will see it, they'll give glory to God, and then that light that shines in us will start shining in them. So we do that so there is one body acting together in unity, following the Spirit for his glory. Next slide. God has worked on this in a mighty way. You're starting to see, just like we announced this morning, how on Tuesday night there's a prayer service for churches across our region to pray for our country and our city and our area. That's happening at the Civic Center in Monroe this Tuesday night at 6:30. And we encourage people to go to that. Instead, we're not even doing anything here because we want people to go to that. Because God has started putting it on the hearts of people to come work together. But we have to do that ourselves. We have to be part of that process. We must begin to walk in one Spirit to bring glory to God. But there's always that hard question, but how do I know who's a Christian? How do I know who's part of the body? okay, God, I understand you want me to overlook some faults in my brothers. How do I know who actually is my brother? Next verse. 1 John 3:4-11 says, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. So Jesus came about to take away our sins, so those who follow him are not going to be people who walk in sin continually. Whoever abides in him or lives in him does not sin. So if you say, I live in Christ and Christ lives in me, you're not going to live a life of sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. Next slide. Little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Next slide. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. Next slide. Verse 10. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest, or easy to tell. It's easy to tell who's of God, who's not. Those who walk in sin or live in a life of sin, they're not of God. If you're walking in continual sin, well, I can tell they're not of God. If they are walking in righteousness, not to say that you don't ever sin, you're saying if you're walking in sin. So then it should be easy for us to be able to say, okay, they're walking in sin. They have sin that people address in their life and they're not repenting of it. They don't care to obey God. It's easy to tell. For this is a message you've heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. So then that passage actually keeps going on and starts describing that you should also love your brother. And that's the other thing we should understand, is that those that are Christians, it's easy to tell. They're going to have a great love for other believers, and they're not going to walk in continual sin. So then for us, when we're going to say, who we partner with to go do this work of God, to be this light inside this world, it's easy. Those that have a heart to follow God and not walking in continual sin, and those that love other believers with all their heart, that are willing to give up their life for them. So that's, okay, that's easy. Next one. So we separate over lots of things in the church. But here he makes it easy. John makes it easy to kind of tell what the difference is between a believer and an unbeliever. It's easy to tell who is of God and who is of the devil. Do they love and give up themselves for other believers? Do they live a life of righteousness or a life of sin? So once they have those things, then we can say, I can walk with them. So then Ephesians 1:11-14 says this. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who works all. We've already read that. Do what? Go skip through that. We won't be on Ephesians 1:11-14 at all. Go to John 7:16. It says, Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but he who sent me. If anyone wills to do his will, he shall know concerning the doctrine, whether it is from God or whether I speak of my own authority. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Did not Moses give you the law, yet none of you keep the law? Why do you seek to kill me? So Jesus makes this statement. He says, those that are doing righteousness are those that seek glory for God and not for themselves. So you have three things to tell whether someone is, a body is trying to serve God. They're walking righteously, they love brothers, and they're not seeking their own glory. Once we see those things, we can walk hand in hand with people. But when you see people seeking their own glory, trying to build their own kingdom, you'd say, okay, hey, I'm not going to walk with that body. Do they seek their own glory, power, riches, or God's? And if they are seeking God's glory, we can walk with them. But it doesn't mean we won't disagree on theology. So I'll tell you something, I probably disagree with all of y'all in theology on something. So then our view of walking with other congregations should be those three things. So we're going to go to Isaiah 58, 1 through 14. It says, "Cry aloud, spare not, lift up your voices like a trumpet, tell my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness and did not forsake the ordinances of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. They take delight in approaching God." Sounds good. "Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen? Why have we afflicted our soul and you have not taken notice? In fact, in the days of your fast, you find pleasure," is what God says back to them, "and exploit all your laborers. Indeed, you fast for strife and debate, and you strike with a fist of wickedness. You will not fast as you do this day to make your voice heard on high." So God says, hey, look, you're fasting for me to hear you, but you're treating people wrong. "Is it a fast that I've chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it a bow down his head like a bulrush and to spread out sackcloths and ashes? Would you call this a fast and an acceptable day of the Lord?" He says, "Is this not a fast that I've chosen?" So then God's telling him, this is the kind of fast I want. If you want to approach me, if you want to be close to me, if you want to be used by me, he says, this is the kind of fast I want. That you loose the bonds of wickedness, that you undo the heavy burdens, that you let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. So how might we as a church do that? Do we not know the one who breaks chains? Do we not know the one who goes and frees people of sin? So he's saying, look, I don't want you to come to me and be like, oh God, I'm praying to you, God. I hadn't eaten for 2 days. Will you hear my call? He's saying, no, the fast I want is that you start spreading my good news to break the bonds of wickedness, to remove those heavy burdens of the people that you know, to let the oppressed go free, those drug addicts that you know, that you go and you speak to them to turn them from their evil ways. He says, is it not to share your bread with the hungry and that you bring to your house the poor who are cast out? When you see the naked, that you cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh? He's saying, like, what I really want is that you go help the least of these. What I really want is that you go and you spread this good news and you go do, you be my hands and feet. That's what I really want. Next slide. Then your light shall break forth like the morning. You know how we're saying it's so dark outside? It says, then your light shall break forth like the morning. Your healing shall spring forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then it will happen. Then we'll see this world change. When we get out of this and start going out and sharing that good news, that's when we'll see it start changing. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer, and you shall cry and he will say, here I am. If you take away the yoke from your midst, the pointing finger and speaking wickedness, if we remove from our mouths speaking evil of others, remove from our mouths the division that we have between each other, oh, they're wrong because they believe this, and they're wrong because they believe this, and they're wrong because they believe this. Next. If you extend your soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then your light shall dawn in the darkness, and your darkness shall be as noonday. Then we'll see this country change, this world change, your neighborhood change, your family change. Then you will. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose water do not fail. Next verse. Those from among you shall build the old waste place. You shall raise up the foundation of many generations. You shall be called the repair of the breach, the restore of the streets to dwell in. Isn't that what we want? We want our families to be built back up. We want the church to be built back up into one body. We want to see God move among this place. We want to see his light go out into this world. Isn't that what we want? He's telling you how to do it. It's not that we go and we say, oh, God, please work among us. No, give up of your time. Quit making your life all about you. Quit searching after things that's going to burn up. Trying to build your own kingdom. And say, man, why is this world getting darker? Why is it that the world around us, sin is just coming in? It's because we have been self-consumed and prideful. We've been doing things that's all about us. He said, if you want to see that light go out, go help the people that are the least of these. Go spread the good news to break the chains of those who are in addiction and those who are lost and consumed with their sin. Then we'll see the light go out. Then you'll see the body come together. Next one. If you turn away your foot from the Sabbath, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy day of the Lord honorable, and shall honor him, not doing your own ways, nor finding your own pleasure, nor speaking your own words. Next slide. Then you shall delight yourself in the Lord, and I will cause you to rise on the high hill of the earth, and feed you with the heritage of Jacob your father, the mouth of the Lord has spoken. He says, then I will act. Then you will see me move. Next slide. Do we want to see the darkness removed? Then we must help the least of these. We must be the repairer of the breach of the denominations. We must bring the body to work together. And we must honor God's commands. Damn, I'm going to skip Isaiah 60 and go to John 8:12. Jesus said, spoke to them again, saying, I'm the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. If we will follow his example, Jesus is not stuck. Jesus is walking all over the place, trying to reach people. So I want to encourage you, leave your house. Go talk to your neighbor. Go talk to the person that you know is consumed with sin. The one that you know is miserable. The one that you know is full of what you would say complete worldliness. In your neighborhood. You don't even have to go do it in some crazy place. In your neighborhood. We are supposed to be part of that light of the world. His spirit inside us should cause us to be the light. That we bear the hate of the world. We bear the hate of each other to cause one body to come together to change the world. The light in us that the world will come, it is the light in us that the world will come to, is Yeshua. That light in us is him. So, but you actually have to spend time to hear his voice. All those things I told you that are going to pass away, you're not hearing his voice because you're so focused on those things. You're going to have time that you're quiet to hear his voice to lead you. When he does rule our life, it's radiant. He then radiates our life, and people are like, man, there's something different about them. So the next question, is he ruling your life so that the world can see the light? Does the world look at your life and want to give glory to God? Do they look at your life and they want to change and live for Christ? Like, be honest with yourself. That's your whole purpose. That's my whole purpose. Why God created each of us. is that we would be light bearers for him. And then we can right now look at the world around us and be like, man, it's so dark. It's so dark everywhere. It's because there's just a little candle inside each of us instead of this big light shining out of us that's going off and reaching others. 2 Corinthians 4 says, therefore, since we have this ministry as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. So we're getting rid of all that shame in our life, that sin in our life. Verse 3, but even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. So they don't believe. They're full of darkness unless the light of Christ in you shines on them. There's another verse that says, how will they know unless someone sent? How will they know unless someone tells them? So unless we are going and sharing that with those that we love, that light is not being shined into their life. Verse 5 says, for we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservant for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who commands light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So it's him in us. It's not us. It's him in us that will shine into others' lives. But if you don't have him in you, you can't shine into others' lives. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. So we're going through this trouble so that God can then work inside of our soul, that thing that will actually live on for eternity, that he can work on our soul to change us to be more like him, that the world can see him. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So we are constantly dying so we may look more and more like him. So then death is working us, but life in you. And since we have the same spirit of faith according to what is written, I believed and therefore I spoke. We also believe and therefore speak, knowing that he who raised up the Lord Jesus will also raise us up with Jesus and will present us with you. For all things are for your sake, that grace, having spread through the many, may cause the thanksgiving to abound to the glory of God, that we might go through anything in this life to change our soul so that we give glory to God. So anything you go through in this life, any hardship you're going through, any trouble you're going through, is that God might change you to bring about glory to him in his name. So then if you go back to what we talked about earlier, how this is just like our bodies, we're outside of our bodies again. God is trying to change that soul inside you. He's trying to change that. And this trouble that you see happening to your flesh is just to change your soul. Next verse. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceedingly an eternal weight of glory. So that hardship that's happening to you is to achieve a greater glory for the time to come. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So we're not looking at all these things that are going to pass away. We're not going to try to find our joy in all these things that are going to pass away. We're not looking at these temporary things in this life when, think of it, if you're playing a video game and you're there, I don't know if some of y'all might never played a video game, and you're in some video game and the building just crashed down and like all this trouble starts happening inside that game. You're like, oh man, my game's being messed up. But it really doesn't bother you because you know it's a game. He's saying here, hey, look, all this stuff happened here, it shouldn't really worry us because this is not the eternal thing. These are temporary things that are going to pass away. This is temporary hardship that's going to pass away. There's the eternal soul inside you that will keep living, that you should focus on the things that matter for eternity, not on the things that matter for this moment. And ours, we actually get it. You guys know it. You guys know that this stuff will all pass away. Right? We know that. And that there's this soul inside of us that will live forever one day. And we'll carry on. He says he rewards you one day for the life that you live here for him. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Next slide. The reason this world is dark is because we have become lazy to share this light. It's true. How many people in here can say, I'm a follower of Christ? And then one time God convicted me and said, Nathan, how many people have you led to me? How many people have you gone out and actually led to me? Like, his whole mission was to lead people back to God and commit their heart to him. That's the next point. They won't believe us unless the light of Jesus is shining on them. So unless we're full of it, of him, they're not going to believe it. And how will they know unless someone tells them? You know, we're so scared. I was talking to this other pastor, and he was saying, Nathan, I've realized that, you know, we as a church have done wrong. You know, we've got put all the duty on the pastor. So everybody has to be that the pastor needs to do everything. They need to be the one that leads people to Christ. All the people need to do is just show up, maybe bring a friend every now and then. He said, I'm trying to tell our congregation that we need to go out and share the gospel. He said, but they're so consumed with themselves, they can't even think about what it would be to go and talk to someone else about Jesus because they're so consumed with what everyone else would think about them. He said, so I'm just trying to address that they don't need to be consumed with themselves so that they can actually share this gospel. I said, oh, yeah. And if we're honest with ourselves, that's true. We are so worried what anyone else would think about us that we can't even go share it because I'm worried that you might think I'm crazy. I can do it on Facebook. I can't do it in real life. So if we don't want to see the world become dark, the church must leave their four walls and reach the people at home. The church must start acting as one body guided by one spirit. So we must see how can we partner with people. How can we work with other denominations? How can we be one body to work together? The church must obey God's commands and uphold biblical discipline. That's why the world looks at us and says, man, they look just like the world. So unless the church upholds biblical discipline and you uphold biblical discipline in your own life and family, the world won't believe it. The church must seek to glorify God and not men. Next slide. And each of these things must start with each of us first. Because we can look at all these churches and say, oh, they're not doing this, and they're not doing this, and they're not doing this. But really, it's I'm not doing this. I'm not doing this. I'm not doing it in my own family. I'm not making Christ most important in my own family. I'm not sharing the gospel in my own family. The most important thing in my family is not that we have Bible study each night, it's to do everything else. But the church needs to do this. The light must shine in your own house first before it can shine out into anything else. Who will you speak to this week to show this light that is in you? If you're not purposeful to plan, purposeful to pray, you're not going to do it. What will you endure this week for the glory of God? What will you endure? People talking bad about you, people speaking evil of you. Will you endure that for the glory of God? Will you forgive people for the glory of God? Will you get rid of any kind of hate that you have for the glory of God or any disagreement you have with other people for the glory of God? Because that is our duty. And last question is, are you full of light or darkness? Because we can look around us and say, man, the world is full of darkness when we are full of darkness. So are you full of light or darkness? Next slide, Matthew 5:13-16 says, you are the salt of the earth, but the salt loses flavor. How shall it be seasoned? Is it then good for nothing but to throw out and trample underfoot by men? You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. You understand when he says this? He says for us to let your light so shine before men so that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. That is purposeful by us. Something that we choose to do. But there's no light in you. You got nothing to shine. So ask again, do you feel like things are getting dark in this world? Don't hide the light. And if you don't have that light, it might be time that you give your life completely to him. God does not want a piece of you. He wants your whole soul, your whole being, all that you are. He wants your life to be about him and not about you. And in Christianity in America, we've made it be okay to give a piece to God, give a day to God, give a little time to God. But God wants everything. He wants full custody of a wife who is completely committed to him. He wants children completely committed to him, and he wants servants completely committed to him. And if you want to see that light inside your life, it takes full commitment to him. And he will not let you down. I promise you he won't. Join me in prayer. Father, I just ask that you'd help us number our days. Help us to see this world as passing away. That it's just a time that you can form us into your image. And that we would put value on things that you put value. And we would put importance on the things that you put importance on. That you'd help us to see your people and recognize who is yours and who is not. And that we would have such a love for others that we would share gospel, your gospel to them. Father, I just ask that you'd help us not to be consumed by this life. And not to think that we would just see this world as passing away. And that we would be consumed with bringing glory to your name. and that we would not hold on to things that will burn up, and that we will not spend our time with things that will burn up, that our hope would be completely in you. Father, I thank you for speaking to us and letting us come before you, our Maker. And I just ask that you would speak to each person's heart today, that if they are in darkness, that they would not lie to themselves. And lie to themselves saying that they have the light when there is only darkness in them. That you would convict them to give their hearts completely to you. And that you would convict them to live a life worthy of your calling. Father, we love you. We bless you. We come to you in Yeshua's name.